Good evening, everyone. If you could please find a seat. It's great to be with you. Welcome to the third event for our Constitution and Constitution Literacy Series, put on by the Constitution and Civility Center of American Heritage School. My name's Adam Brewer, and I'll be conducting this meeting. We're so excited to welcome our live audience and those of us that are joining us remotely on the YouTube live stream. We'd just like to make notes to the audience members that there are snacks out in the lobby for you to eat while you watch our debate this evening. We do ask that you do keep the hot chocolate, however, out in the lobby so that we can keep the North Auditorium nice and clean. We will begin our event this evening with an invocation offered by Karen Mattson, after which James Mattson will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Is Karen here? Oh, there she is. Come on forward. Thank you.
Our dearest Father in heaven, we're so grateful to be here as staff and students of American Heritage and community members to experience this constitutional debate. And we're so grateful that we live in this free land, that we're able to have the comforts that we desire and the freedoms that we have. And we're also so grateful for those who have prepared this message for us tonight to learn more in depth about our Constitution and what that entails. And we love you so much and say this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
One nation under God, please stand. Ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, James and Karen. It sure is gratifying to see so many students here this evening, and just want to give a special welcome to our students who are attending. It's my pleasure to introduce really two of the smartest guys I know and the directors of the Constitution and Civility Center here at American Heritage, David Hancock and Jeff Hymus. David Hancock and Jeff Hymus both serve as full-time high school faculty members at American Heritage School, teaching U.S. history and world government. Political and political science classes. Prior to joining American Heritage School in 2010, David was a practicing attorney. A cum laude graduate of BYU Law School, he has argued dozens of constitutional issues in court and has briefed the United States Supreme Court. Jeff joined American Heritage in 2016 after working with many organizations presenting hundreds of constitution education lectures to live audiences across America. He holds an MBA from Idaho State University and is a cum laude graduate of BYU's Marriott School of Management. I also like to introduce myself. I joined American Heritage School in just this year, as a full-time faculty and currently teach as an eighth grade homeroom teacher. I hold a master's degree in public administration and a doctorate degree in political science from Idaho State University. Before coming to American Heritage, I taught courses and published in both of those subject areas for 8 years in higher education, most notably as a visiting professor at BYU-Idaho and a professor at the University of Montana. I will be serving as the moderator this evening. This evening, you will note on our program that we will be discussing two very important clauses in the U.S. Constitution, the General Welfare Clause and the Necessary and Proper Clause. As such, our program will go as follows. We will first hear from Jeff for 5 minutes on the general welfare. Then we'll hear from David on general welfare, and then he will introduce the Necessary and Proper Clause for a 10-minute lecture. We'll then switch back to Jeff, who will finish off the lecture portion of our evening with a few more thoughts on the Necessary and Proper Clause. Then we will take a 5-minute break. After our 5-minute break, we'll have a moderated debate between Jeff and David on both clauses for about 25 minutes. After that, audience members will have the opportunity to ask questions in a Q&A session to conclude our meeting. For those of you participating remotely, I will be monitoring the chat feed on our YouTube live stream, so please feel free to ask any questions, and I will happily do my best to include those in our Q&A. Let's begin by giving a nice round of applause to our co-directors this evening.
It's good to be here. Thanks for coming. This is exciting to see such a room here. We're going to jump in. Dave and I were trying to decide how to do this and how to make it most effective, and I said, I'm going to limit myself to 5 minutes. And believe it or not, I have like 48 slides I'm going to try to fit into 5 minutes. So we're just going to get going here. If you were here a couple months ago, I had a little analogy I used to describe the Supremacy Clause. We talked about the importance of having a contract. And so we're going to pull up the same contract idea here as we talk about the General Welfare Clause. As you look at the contract, when we talk about the Supremacy Clause, how important it is to have a constitution that decides what happens, okay, between the states and the people and the federal government, the interaction there. As we look at this hypothetical contract, as we take our car into a mechanic and try to get it fixed, there's some things we notice on this that's kind of new to the contract this time. It's this yellow part that's highlighted. It says, I authorize the mechanic shop to make repairs and service my car and to charge me for those costs, okay? So here I am, the happy car owner. I bring it, maybe unhappy because my car's not working, to drop it off. As I'm leaving, they take my K car, right? You guys heard of the K car back in the 70s. And they get it up on the hoist. I'm like, wow, these guys are really efficient. This is cool. This is great. I take off, and a couple days later, come back. As I come back, they're lowering this car down from the hoist. And as I'm walking, they're like, wow, that's a nice car. And, okay, I'm here to pick up my car, guys. It's, oh, great, we're just lowering it on the hoist. I'm like, wait, that thing? That's not my car. No, it is your car. No, that's not my car. No, trust me, sir, it is. We did all kinds of really cool things. Don't you like it? And I respond, well, I kind of like it, but it's not my car. No, it is. We did a paint job. We changed all the engine to a new body. And I say, well, wait, I never authorized that. Like, what's going on here? Okay? And they point to this, and they say, look, it says, I authorize a mechanic shop to make repairs and service my car and to charge you for those costs. So we just kind of did some repairs and took care of that, right? But I point out, no, it wasn't just like an open blank check. It was, I want you to make repairs and service my car to just do these three things, which is change out my spark plugs, flush my transmission, and replace my timing belt. That's it. And they say, well, you didn't say we couldn't put a new body in there and couldn't, you know, paint it really nice and put new tires on it. And I'm like, well, yeah, but how contracts work is not like I have to list, don't repaint my car, and don't change out my engine, and don't replace my tires and wheels. Contract is simple. Look, here's the list, and these are the things you do. I don't have to write every little thing you can't do or shouldn't do. Otherwise, I'll be here all day long, right? Okay? You didn't necessarily like that, but to move through this analogy here, we're going to take the General Welfare Clause, and I'll take the actual words of the General Welfare Clause and try to push them into this analogy, okay? In the General Welfare Clause, it says, the Congress shall have power to provide for the common defense and general welfare. And remember, in this case, Congress actually is represented by the mechanic shop. And we can talk about repairs and services. Okay, so the mechanic shop shall have power to provide for the repairs and service my car. We're going to take the General Welfare Clause kind of modified for the analogy, and we're going to stick it up in that yellow box. Okay, mechanic shop shall have power to provide for the repairs and to service my car. And so you'd ask, well, what repairs and what services? I think it's clear. It's those ones right there. Okay. Now, if we go ahead and slide in the actual words of the Constitution of the General Welfare Clause, Congress shall have power to provide for the common defense and general welfare. And now we're not talking about the analogy anymore, we're talking about powers of government, not the powers in the mechanic shop, but the powers of government. And when you look through here, they actually list those, okay? So in the same way that you go to the mechanic shop, say, I want you to take care of repairs and services, also, I wonder if this is getting feedback. Okay. In the same way, there's a listing of the things that Congress can do, not just a blank check, but here's those specific things, okay? So in Article 1, Section 8 are listed the powers of Congress, the majority of those listed powers of Congress. And as you look through this, you'll see this idea of general welfare. And general welfare not just meaning generally what's good for the people, whatever you want to do, you just decide. General welfare meaning these things, okay? Things like regulating interstate commerce, things like coining money, okay? There's also common defense, and that's an interesting one. It's not just general welfare, but it's common defense. And the common defense ones are also lined out. When you look at common defense, there's clauses 10 through 17. And those are things like declaring war, like raising supporting armies and providing and maintaining a navy. Those things make sense as common defense powers. Okay? So the general welfare clause is lined out that way. So when you open your constitutions, if you brought your pocket constitutions, this is where I would tell my students, pull out your constitution and start highlighting like mad, because we're going to get into this and really get into the words of it. Article 1, Section 8, clauses 1 through 18 are on this page 6 and 7 of the typical pocket constitution that a lot of people have. When you look at this, we can identify there's kind of a precursor to all the Article 1, Section 8. It's this word, the words Congress shall have power to, right? Congress shall have power to borrow money. Congress shall have power to regulate commerce. Congress shall have power to establish a uniform rule of naturalization. In this case, it's Congress shall have power to provide for the common defense and general welfare. And just like we looked on the example of the contract, when you highlight the words general welfare, well, what general welfare? Well, it's talking about these ones right here, clauses 2 through 9. That's your general welfare. Not general welfare, whatever you think, but general welfare meaning as applied to these things. And then also you go to the common defense, and that's where I was telling them to highlight in a different color here. Your common defense powers are clauses 10 through 17. Those are your common defense powers, okay? The ones that relate to what we mean by when we're enabling the Congress to do something, not just general welfare in general, do what you think, or common defense, oh, do what you think is good for defense, but meaning, oh no, these are the specific things we want you to do as that general authorization of power gives you at the top. Okay, so you go through it. If you have a class from me, your constitution always has different colors on page 6 and 7, a ton of different colors on it. I'm gonna go through what I consider some good quotes that support my idea, okay? So that's an idea, that's an interpretation. Some people say it's not very textual, you're kind of just implying that's what they meant by that. But my viewpoint is James Madison and Thomas Jefferson supporting that is kind of some good backup to me, right? Probably is a more reliable or credible backup. James Madison says this, "Nothing is more natural nor common than first to use the general phrase and then to explain and qualify it by a recital of particulars." Okay, the idea of, yeah, the general phrase is general welfare. The general phrase is common defense. And the recital of particulars, the specifics, is what's listed below in Article 1, Section 8. Okay, that's normal. That's how we talk. That's how we summarize and then in detail, right? He goes on to say, in a different quote actually, "With respect to the words general welfare, I've always regarded them as qualified by the detail of powers connected with them. To take them in a literal and unlimited sense would be a metamorphosis of the Constitution into a character which there is a host of proofs was not contemplated by its creators." Okay? To say, let's just generally open, do what you want to do, he says, that violates, that there's a host of proofs that shows that's not what the founders wanted. And lastly, another quote from him, "If Congress can do whatever in their discretion can be done by money and will promote the general welfare, the government is no longer a limited one, possessing enumerated powers." And when they say enumerated is like numbered or listed. "It's no longer a government that is limited, possessing enumerated powers, but an indefinite one subject to particular exceptions," right? It's not, if you don't interpret the way he is interpreting the general welfare clause, I'm interpreting the general welfare clause, then what you look at is a government that can do whatever except for a few things, rather than as he sees it and I see it, as a government that is limited to just a few enumerated powers. Okay, we'll go into one more quote here in a couple of slides, and then I'll turn it over to Mr. Hancock. To me, this is one of the most succinct. I'm a Jefferson guy, okay? One of my sons I named Jefferson. I like Jefferson, so I'm gonna throw in this quote. I think this quote is very succinct. "They, Congress, are not to do anything they please to provide for the general welfare. To consider otherwise would render all the preceding and subsequent enumerations of power completely useless." And this is the quote, this is the part that I love. It would reduce the whole Constitution to a single phrase, that of instituting a Congress with power to do whatever it would be for the good of the United States. And as they would be the sole judges of the good or evil, it would be also a power to do whatever evil they please. Certainly, no such universal power was meant to be given them. It was intended to lace them up straightly within the enumerated powers. Okay? Hopefully, those quotes make sense to substantiate or kind of support the ideas I was presenting earlier. Jefferson also said this in a very simple way. Congress has not unlimited powers to provide for the general welfare, but were restrained to those specifically enumerated. And like we said before, enumerated means written down. So, I like to think of it as this, a simple phrase, if it's not listed, you can't do it. Kind of like with my mechanic shop, right? If it's not listed, you can't do it. You can't repaint my car, all that stuff. I'm just, the things I want you to do, I've listed them what I want you to do. Okay, if it's not listed, you can't do it. We get different interpretations. I think more contemporary interpretations. This is by Francis Biddle, who is the Attorney General under FDR. He said the government of the United States can do anything not specifically prohibited by the Constitution. Now, at first you think, I think it's saying, no, actually he's not saying the same thing. He's saying the exact opposite, right? Where Jefferson says, if it's not listed, you can't do it. Biddle comes along and says this, as long as it doesn't specifically say we can't, then we can. Okay, which is a different idea. It's a mechanic who says, it doesn't say in here, I can't repaint your car, I can't turn your Pinto or your K car into a Ferrari, so therefore I can. And there's a different view on that. I did pretty good. I stayed within 5 minutes maybe.
What you can tell is that Jeff really did get his K car turned into a Ferrari, because a K car could never go that fast. I drove one, and I remember it did not go that fast. So that's impressive. I had money riding on a bet with Adam that he would never be able to get through that in 5 minutes. So we do have very different views on these two clauses, and they're quite different. It's interesting to me that sometimes he says that I look at things in these kind of elaborate ways, and I look at all kinds of stuff, and I say, yeah, but you look at them really simplistically. And today, it's kind of the reverse. I think that Jeff looks at these kind of in a convoluted way, and I look at that fairly simplistically with the general welfare clause. And as a result of that, I think that my explanation of it is really pretty simple and pretty straightforward. So here we have the General Welfare Clause, and I've put the whole thing here. And part of this whole thing is a little bit confusing, so I'm going to delete it in just a second, but just so that you can see the whole clause, where it says, Congress shall have power to, and then it has all this stuff, and then it says, and provide for the common defense. All that stuff there basically means that they have the power to tax and spend. Okay, so all of those different things are different kinds of taxes. And so what Clause 1 of Article 1, Section 8 says is that Congress shall have power to tax and spend for the common defense and general welfare of the United States. And to me, that is a pretty straightforward statement and a pretty straightforward interpretation. And it does raise a little bit of question. What does commonwealth or general welfare mean? And it is something that has been raised from time to time by various founders of the United States. Mr. Hymas Jeff has named one of his sons Jefferson. One of my sons is named James. It's not after James Madison, though, so that's not quite the same thing. But, and I really think this is pretty simple and pretty straightforward. Now, here is that quote from Thomas Jefferson, and I actually really do agree with this. The laying of taxes is the power, and the general welfare, the purpose for which is the power is to be exercised. And this is one of the places where I take a little bit of exception to what Jeff was arguing, is that I don't think this is a broad, unlimited grant of power. But what it is a broad grant of power with respect to what Congress can tax and what they can spend. Does that make sense? So the General Welfare Clause doesn't give Congress the power to go out and do this crazy thing. In class, I sometimes use this analogy that they're going to build freedom land. Okay? They're going to build it on the outskirts of Washington, D.C., and lots of tourists are going to come and whatever. I don't think they can do that. They don't have the power in the Constitution to build freedom land. But what do they do have the power to? To tax and spend. As long as they determine that it's for the general welfare of the United States. So I believe that to be very broad. And then it says, they are not to lay taxes ad libitum for any purpose they please, but only to pay the debts or provide for the welfare of the Union. And I think that's exactly what it says. In like manner, they are not to do anything they please to provide for the general welfare, but only to lay taxes for that purpose. And so I think what the problem is with the general welfare clause is a lot of people think of it, or the argument of it being that it's just this broad grant of power. But I don't think it is a broad grant of power. It is a broad grant of power to tax and spend, but not a broad grant of power in other respects. Now, I'm going to introduce you a little bit to a form of constitutional interpretation, which is sometimes called structuralism. And what I'm doing is looking at the way that the grammar of this all works. And I've simplified this so that you can kind of understand what I'm talking about here. But one of the grammatical arguments about the general welfare clause is that there is no significant or substantial difference in the general welfare clause as a grant of power than there is to other clauses in Article 1, Section 8. Structurally, it is the same. And so what I've tried to do is make that point here, perhaps in a poor way, but it says, the Congress shall have power. Now that's the first part of that clause, and then it goes on to tax and spend for the general welfare. And then it says, to borrow money, to regulate commerce, to establish a uniform rule of naturalization, to coin money, and then down at the very end, to make all laws which are necessary and proper. And what you can see is that in Section 8, you have this series of grants of power to Congress. Congress shall have the power to do this, and the power to do this, and the power to do this. And so I think that Madison's argument that the general welfare part is trying to modify all of these things is inaccurate. As any person who has taken English at American Heritage, right, in the 7th or 8th grade and has diagrammed sentences ad infinitum, that you would know that these are modifiers. And what are they modifying? And this here is modifying this, not these things down below. So clauses 2 through 18 are additional grants of power, not what clause 1 is modifying. Now this is what structuralists do. They look through things, they look at similarities in language, they look at syntax, grammar, overall organization, and they try to make conclusions from that. And so that is essentially my idea, but I also go to the Webster's 1828 dictionary. Which is the only English language dictionary that exists in America at or around this time period. And so let's take a look at what general means. General means public, common, relating to or comprehending the whole community as the general interest or safety of a nation. I think it's interesting that Webster did that, including it as the nation as a whole. And then when we look at welfare, it says, exemption from misfortune, sickness, calamity, or evil, the enjoyment of health, and the common blessing of life, prosperity, happiness, applied to persons. And so when we're looking at the general welfare, what we're looking at is something that will benefit the nation as a whole. And so my argument on this is that Congress has the power to tax and spend, provided it benefits the nation as a whole. And who gets to make that decision? Congress does. Now remember that they are the representatives of the people. They represent different things. But they couldn't tax and spend to benefit themselves, but they can tax and spend in a way that benefits the nation as a whole. All right, so that is essentially my interpretation of the general welfare clause. But I don't want to stop there. I want to keep going because I think that the necessary and proper clause works hand in hand with the general welfare clause. So the necessary and proper clause is at the end of Section 8. It's have this omnibus clause is what I call it. Sometimes in the law when we're talking about a contract clause that gives all these different residual powers, we call it a pour-over clause, where it's saying, by the way, we're giving you anything that you need in order to do what we said you could do. And that's what it says. Congress shall have power to make all laws which shall be necessary and proper for carrying into execution the foregoing powers and all other powers vested by this Constitution in the government of the United States or in any department or officer thereof. And so what this is saying is, hey, we're giving you all of the things that you need to do your job. Imagine if you have a job and you walk in and they say, okay, you're hired for this job, but we're not going to give you tools. We're going to give you a screwdriver and a crowbar, and that's it. But you've got a nail. You can't do it. And so instead they're saying, hey, we're going to give you the tools you need. Yeah. So the important phrase here is necessary and proper. And these are the three words that have caused a lot of debate throughout history in the United States. The debate existed very early on and has continued up until our present day. In fact, there's a very famous instance in the making of the First Bank of the United States where President George Washington asked his cabinet members to submit their opinions to him in writing on the constitutionality of chartering a bank. This is something that the Constitution allows him to demand or require is opinions in writing. And Thomas Jefferson submits an opinion, and on the other hand is Alexander Hamilton. And they submit two competing opinions. And they are very, very different. And they interpret this necessary and proper clause quite differently. Now, this ultimately results in a case, it's a very famous case in the United States called Marbury versus Madison, involving the Second Bank of the United States. There's a lot of fun history about the Marbury case and what all happened with this. But in this case, Chief Justice John Marshall is writing the opinion for the court, and he talks about a number of things. I'm not going to read all this. You can read it if you want, as it's up here behind me. But the argument that was being made by the people who opposed the Bank of the United States was that, Constitution doesn't say anything about a bank. Bank isn't mentioned in there once. You can't do it. And Judge Marshall looks at this and he says, basically the choice, the argument that you're making is that the Constitution says that you can only do what is absolutely necessary. A word used by both Jefferson and Marshall in explaining this position was nugatory, which I think is really cool and sounds like a candy bar. It means that it has no force and effect or unless it's absolutely, completely necessary. Here's another part of this quote, and what here Judge Marshall does, or Justice Marshall does, is he says, but does necessary really need that, mean that? And so that raises that interesting question. What does necessary mean? Now, in our daily life, we oftentimes talk about things that we need, right? And we have this colloquial understanding that need doesn't really mean need unless we put something in front of it. I really need, or I absolutely need, or I positively cannot live without need this, okay? And so we have this concept in our normal everyday language, and I know what you're all thinking. You're thinking, yeah, but what did it mean in 1797? So we'll take a look at that. And this, again, is this structural argument. Section 8, Clause 18, that's on the left, and over on the right we've got Article 1, Section 10, Clause 2. And what we see here is that the Constitutional Convention, when they were writing this, they knew how to use the word necessary. And they used it twice in the Constitution. And what I think is really important is how they phrase it. And as a structuralist, this is very, very significant to me. On the left, what I can see is that they're using necessary alone. And on the right, later, when they're talking about what the states cannot do, they use the phrase absolutely necessary. Now, to me, what that says is Congress must have understood that there is a difference in the way that that word is used. And consequently, this means that necessary means something other than absolutely necessary. Chief Justice Marshall coincidentally agrees with me, or it's the other way around. I'm old enough that sometimes I forget about which comes first. What he says is that they have the ability to do something. I'm going to simplify it. He says that they have the Congress has the choice of using means, the means that they choose. In other words, they get to choose among a broad range of things, so long as that they have been given. Remember, there are 17 grants of power. As long as they can point to one of those 17 or a grant somewhere else in the Constitution, they get to be appropriate. And that's what Chief Justice is. He said that they get appropriate means, and if we instead limit Congress to only those that are specifically mentioned, it ties Congress's hands so much that we're trying to do a constitutional amendment every year to say, hey, it's okay for the president to buy a whole bunch of property for $10 million, which is the Louisiana Purchase, which is something that historically I think is interesting because Jefferson later abandoned the position on the Necessary and Proper Clause and agreed to do the Louisiana Purchase without a constitutional amendment because he said this must be proper. All right, I think I'm going to skip the rest of these because necessary or proper.
So what I find interesting, what I find fascinating is David and I have done this many times, like, what are you talking about? I don't understand what you're talking about. And then when he has a chance, he's like, wow, that totally makes sense. I don't agree with it, but that totally makes sense. And he's had the same experience with me, and it's and that's what we're hoping you're participating in and enjoying at the same time. But wow, these are two clauses, the Necessary and Proper Clause. Makes sense. You can dive in with a little more knowledge and understanding and weightier decisions, the weightier thoughts about what's going on. So I've really enjoyed learning and teaching. You guys know that we teach a Contrasting Views of the Constitution class with our 11th and 12th graders here. And this is what we do. We just go over topic after topic. Topic, and almost to a T, every topic we totally disagree on. It's really fun. So the Necessary and Proper Clause as a limitation on power. See that this, I think, on the limitation of power, you know, how you apply the Necessary and Proper Clause and how you apply the General Welfare Clause is kind of our primary difference in terms of whether it's limiting very strictly in my view or less strictly in David's view, if I've said that fairly, I don't know. So we get this car shop owner who's the people in the state, the mechanic shop, who's the federal government. I like to use this analogy just to help us kind of see what's going on. And the same contract, okay? Same contract, we've already highlighted this idea. And we have kind of a slippery little mechanic shop here, so we want to kind of nail them down and make sure they're not going to keep doing all kinds of crazy things and turning cars into Ferraris, right? You have this general welfare clause up here on the contract. In this case, I just want them to change out my brake pads. I'm pretty clear with them. Look, I want you to change out the brake pads on my front wheels. We got this? Are we clear? Okay. Car shops are known for having really good greasy popcorn and free water, and so I just stick around. I'm like, you know, I'm gonna stay there and eat some greasy free popcorn and press my nose up against the plexiglass and watch them do this to make sure all they do is change my brake pads. That's it. Because I don't trust these guys. Last time I left them, they tried to charge me, you know, couple hundred thousand dollars of change into my Ferrari. So I'm there right in front of me. They see me watching them right in front of me. They know they're supposed to change the brake pads, and here they are taking off my wheel. There's nothing on the contract that says anything about the wheel. And so I go in there and I'm waving my contract, like, hey, look at this, you know. It doesn't say, where in the world does it say wheel? And they say, well, sir, I have to take off the wheel to get to the brake pad, right? Okay, but they also point out down here, I authorize the mechanic shop to do those things which are necessary and proper. And sir, it is necessary. We do need to take off your wheel in order to get the brake pad. So I walk back sheepishly with my leg, my tail between my legs, like, yo, carry on, good job, way to go, keep going. And realize, yeah, I guess that does make sense. They do need to do that. Okay, so we're gonna do the same thing we did before, and we're gonna try to pull this concept into the actual words of the Constitution. So here's your necessary and proper clause. A Congress shall have power to make all laws that shall be necessary and proper. Okay, we're gonna take this guy up here, and we're gonna throw it down this language at the bottom of our contract. Oh, sorry, first of all, we're gonna say the Congress is represented by the mechanic shop to do those things, okay, that should be necessary and proper. We're gonna take that and put it down here in the bottom of the contract. The mechanic shall have power to do those things that shall be necessary and proper. Okay? Now, we're going to change the words here into the actual words of the Constitution. The Congress shall have power to make all laws that shall be necessary and proper. So when you pull out your Constitution, we've already got it highlighted with our general welfare powers, our common defense powers, and we're going to look at this part, right? Congress shall have power to make all laws that shall be necessary and proper. Okay? Okay, so pulling out those words up on the screen so we can look at them just clearly here. We have an issue, okay? We've talked about the idea that the mechanic shop can only do those things which are necessary and proper in order to change out my brake pads. And we're clear, like, oh, that's kind of misunderstanding, but I get it now. Yeah, you can take off the wheel. Even though it doesn't say you can, you actually can because it's necessary and proper in order to get to the brake pads, right? But here I am, I'm the strict constitutional. What it says is what it means, right? And we kind of run into an issue because it says right here, Congress shall have the power to make all laws that shall be necessary and proper. So how do you take the actual words of the Constitution, not just look at the analogy, but look at the words of the Constitution. What do you do? Because when you look at that, to me, there's a little bit of a dilemma. Like, who decides what's necessary and proper? If you look at Article 1, Section 8, Clause 18, the necessary and proper clause, it kind of looks like Congress gets to decide that, right? So here we are stuck. Do I just go, well, you have to have an analogy in order to understand the Constitution. Or maybe you just look at the next seven words, right? And the next seven words are, okay, so I got to hit myself. I wonder, so stop, pause for a second there, okay? The concept here, let's say we go back to the analogy for a second. We go to the car shop, and we go to pick up our car, and he's cut a hole in this and made a sunroof out of my car. And then I have a legitimate concern, right? My legitimate concern is, look, if you want to get to the brake pads, you don't need to cut a hole in the roof of the car. That's not necessary in order to change out my brake pads, okay? And I hope we'd agree that's true, even though he says, no, it's necessary and proper. It's necessary to do that. I mean, don't you think that people are happier with a sunroof? Don't you agree that it is necessary and proper for people's happiness? You're like, no, I mean, that's not the issue. I don't want you to... It says, in order to make the repairs listed above. And so really, this necessary and proper applies to making these, okay? So in other words, if you want to take off the tire to get to the brake pads, that's totally legitimate because it is necessary in order to make the repairs listed above. But if you want to cut a hole in the top of the car in order to change out the brake pads, that's totally illegitimate. That doesn't make sense. Okay, so now we get back to what I was saying earlier. What do we do, though? We have this idea that... The analogy is cool, I think it makes sense, but is that how you interpret it? The only way you can look at the Constitution? And here's where you need to read the next seven words of the Constitution. Because what it says is, the Congress shall have power to make all laws that shall be necessary and proper for carrying into execution the foregoing powers. And when you look at those words, foregoing might be a little confusing, or necessary and proper, carrying into execution. Well, let's just look at them in terms of a condition, right? The necessary and proper, it's not just that it's necessary and proper, it has to comply with this condition. The condition is it has to carry into execution the foregoing power. So let's pull out our Constitution, and let's look and say, really, the issue here isn't Congress has power to make all laws that shall be necessary and proper. The issue is the next seven words, and those are the ones that I would highlight and underline. For carrying into execution the foregoing powers. And when it says the foregoing powers, it's referring to the ones that are foregoing, right? The ones that are just listed. So I always have my students write in there, foregoing powers means the just listed ones. Like those ones, and like those ones, and like those ones. Congress has the power only to make all laws that shall be necessary and proper to carry into execution the foregoing listed powers. Not as just another thing listed that they can do in this list of things Congress can do, but it points to, this directly points to and controls what those necessary and proper applies to. So when you look at it, you have your general welfare powers, okay? And then on the bottom, at the very end of Article 1, Section 8, is Clause 18, which is the necessary and proper clause. And everything there in the middle is the stuff that can be done, okay? I like to think of it kind of this way, as a sandwich, right? The top piece of bread is the general welfare clause. The bottom piece of bread is the necessary and proper clause. And everything in between is the meat, is what Congress can do. I think that's it. Yeah, that is it. So there's a little bit of a difference between Mr. Hancock and I in terms of explanation and teaching. Now we're going to spend about a half an hour doing a debate, which will be moderated by Mr. Brewer, by Adam, after the break. We'll take a five-minute break now and welcome you to enjoy the refreshments. Don't bring them in here, but enjoy them there. Thanks.
Thank you.
We're going to go ahead and get started again. If the audience would, let's go ahead and give a round of applause just to encourage those in the lobby to come on in. Well, this already tonight has just been just wonderful to hear from these two gentlemen. We're going to start our debate this evening by discussing general welfare. And I just want to first ask Jeff. I was pretty clear that Jeff and David had a different understanding and interpretation of the general welfare clause. And I'm curious, what are your thoughts on David's interpretation that it really is a tax and spend type of clause in the Constitution?
Yeah, I think there's no doubt that it is about taxing and spending. I think the question and the difference is taxing and spending in and of itself because that's what the Congress wants to do and things should happen, or are they limited to what they can tax and spend about? And so the example he used about freedom land, we brought that up in our class we had probably 2 months ago, or maybe a month ago. I would firmly disagree with that idea that they can tax and spend. As long as Congress thinks it's in the general welfare of the United States, they can use that tax and spend power to create a freedom land, right? Some type of Disneyland-esque organization or place. To me, I'm saying, well, no, they can't do that because the issue isn't whether they can tax and spend to do whatever they want. The issue is, can they tie that taxing and spending to one of the following clauses, okay? The same idea that Madison said, that there's nothing more natural than to put out your general phrase and follow it by a recital of particulars and have the specifics there. And so I think oversimplifying it, that's good, the feedback's not as bad, that's good. Oversimplifying it is that there's, I don't see it as a blank check, and I think Davis, I don't see it as a blank check either, but I think we do see it fundamentally different in the sense that the general welfare clause is a limiting clause to me. It's saying general welfare, but this, instead of general welfare, look, as long as you guys agree and you get 50% of Congress, 50% plus one to agree on it, then they can do whatever they want. I would say, no, they can't do whatever they want. They can only do what's listed below. And so I think I'm just repeating what I said in my presentation, but I don't know.
You know, and I think that the difference is that I think that it is an independent grant of power. And so it's not tied to another grant. And so you look at various things. So you look at the Affordable Care Act, for example, where President Obama signed in that act. And one of the things that they did is they had two, when it came to the Supreme Court, they had two basic claims on why that particular piece of legislation was valid. One of them had to do with the Commerce Clause. The court mostly rejected that one. But they did adopt it on the general welfare clause, saying that calling that individual mandate a tax allowed it to survive attack by the people that wanted to repeal the Affordable Care Act. And as a result of that, the Supreme Court was able to say, no, this is a tax. And because it's a tax, it doesn't matter whether we find something else in the Constitution that we can point to. It's a tax, therefore Congress can tax it because it's for the general welfare of the United States. And so I think that that's a recent clear example of where it has been used in a broad sense rather than in the more narrow sense that Jeff is advocating for.
So just to clarify, David, you know, you mentioned, you know, in relation to both clauses that, you know, the general welfare clause and the necessary and proper clause, you call an omnibus clause. And you speak to this point that you know, they can be interpreted in a relatively broad sense. How would you address you know, concerns of perhaps audience members or others watching that, you know, essentially general welfare, if interpreted too broadly, is basically a rubber stamp of approval on almost anything that Congress deems of the general welfare?
You know, I think that that's a valid criticism, and especially when it comes to the breadth of their power, and I think it really is quite broad power. I think the difference is that it's limited only to tax and spend, and it doesn't allow them to do other things. So, for example, they wouldn't be able to make something criminal under the general welfare clause. They wouldn't be able to do some other things. They can only tax and spend. Necessary and proper clause, on the other hand, I see as a different thing. It is that omnibus clause. It's, hey, we need to give them all the tools and abilities that they need, and we don't want to have to specify all of them. There's a great clause or a sentence in Justice Marshall's case in Marbury versus Madison where he says, we should never forget that it's a constitution we're interpreting. Where he says, look, this is a constitution, not a statute. It isn't just an easy thing for Congress to go back and fix this. In order to amend the Constitution is a huge issue, and if we don't give the Congress the power they need, then we were going to end up back in the situation where we were under the Articles of Confederation and Perpetual Union, where Congress was powerless. And to use Jefferson's word, it becomes nugatory. I love that word. We should all just go home and say that, nugatory. But it leaves them without any power or any ability.
And I would just respond that the founders, what they found, they said, look, we did have a Congress that was powerless. We couldn't raise taxes. We couldn't do all these things. And so what they did to fix that is they created Article 1, Section 8. The powers, the listed powers there, those are the powers that solve that problem, to borrow money, to carry into effect the things they want to do. I think that swings the pendulum too far. Like, there's obviously in the Articles of Confederation, we have way too little power in Congress. But then say, therefore, we need to let them do whatever they think they should do. Like, whoa, hold on. My view is that what they said is, this is a pretty big deal. It's a big deal to give Congress a lot more power, and because it's such a huge grant of power, we're going to limit it with the 17 things they can do when we say general welfare, instead of just go for it. And then, to me, that's the challenge. So I think we see the same historical problem, which was way too weak. I would say the general welfare interpretation I have stops in a very middle, whereas David's interpretation goes too far, and the pendulum too far, it's too strong, and it is just a rubber stamp. It is a blank, and all they need is to convince enough people. And so one thing, too, is that, you know, the affordable care is an example of that. Well, Justice John Roberts, he's the one who said that, right? It's basically, and I'd say that of a poor opinion. That's not right. That's not the correct application. And yet, and that kind of goes back to what we talked about in terms of, you know, how much validity do you put in the Supreme Court's decisions as an interpretation? But as interpretation, in my mind, that was wrong. It very much does uphold David's idea that it basically. Then period. As long as Obamacare is a tax, they can do it, and we're going to rule that way. There are four justices who didn't agree with that. I said, no, that's not true, that it's supposed to be limited. So just because, I guess, it's interesting, Cola versus Maryland, and talk about, you know, Marbury versus Madison, talk about all these different things, and it's interesting to see that, yes, they may have ruled that way, but that doesn't necessarily make it right. It's just that that's how they ruled, and I think the opinion's still wrong, and I don't think I'm smarter than Chief Justice John Roberts, but I would say,
fair enough. David, any thoughts?
I think it was a bad decision for a number of reasons, but I think that's because of a policy decision. And it didn't actually call it a tax. And I think that was, to me, that's where the decision went bad. Not that, I think it is within Congress's power, tax like that. But I think the difficulty was, is Congress didn't actually say
it. Only Justice Roberts did.
The solicitor. Actually argued that in argument, but the statute never says this is a tax. You'd call it a penalty. And originally had relied on the Commerce Clause. And so I do think it's a bad case just because that it came about. I think the essential holding is justified under the Constitution. And I don't think it's justified under the statute, but I think it's justified under the Constitution. So I have to kind of admit it's got me there a little bit. But.
So what's interesting,
I think that's
is
the first point Jeff's won on.
you both are speaking to some of your disagreements in terms of the Supreme Court and their interpretation of general welfare necessary and proper. I think it should be noted to the audience members that, at least in terms of the necessary and proper clause, the Supreme Court has essentially upheld every single piece of legislation passed using the necessary and proper clause as a justification for the passage of that law. And so, you know, going back to David again, I think Jeff raises some interesting concerns about the potential of government overreach by simply, you know, thinking that either one of these clauses gives them unfettered ability to pass laws with whatever they believe is necessary.
You know, and I understand that. The difficulty that I have with that argument is that the second part of that clause indicates that it's only necessary and proper as to the foregoing powers. And so I think that there are three things that have to be done in order for Congress to be able to pull that in is, number one, they have to identify some kind of a grant of power in the Constitution. So I think that's the first thing. And then they can say, since we have this power, that gives us the ability to choose among a broad range of things. And an analogy that I like to use with it, if you're a contractor and you've been told to build a building and it includes a sidewalk and some other things, you get to decide when and how you pour that sidewalk. There's a lot to do a sidewalk. You can pour it in little pieces as the concrete is available. You could pour it in one big thing. You could put little spacers in, or you can saw cut the concrete. There's lots of ways to do it. You could even use brick, potentially. So there's lots of ways to do that. And unless the contract specifies what the means and methods are to be used by the contractor, then the contractor means and methods for the convenience. And so to pick up on Jeff's analogy about the car, you know, if the mechanic wants to remove the engine for some reason in order to have access to the brake pads, I don't even know if it's physically possible, but let's just say it is, and that it's convenient for him to do that because maybe he has to do some work on the car anyway, and it's just easier to do that and cheaper for him to do that, then why shouldn't he be able to do that? So Congress gets to decide what are the proper means and methods. As long as it is related to another power, as long as it's an appropriate means, and as long as the ends are proper. So I think that there's those three kind of prongs to that. Thoughts?
Yeah. The challenge, I think, is the reason I think it isn't Congress's job is because it's the government of we the people, and what we have is, and Dave and I talk about this all day long. We could talk to anyone who's interested. The difference between a natural rights view of things and a social contract view. A social contract view, in short, is this idea that we enter into a contract and therefore government gets to make decisions because we gave them certain powers to do so. And that's a horrible explanation, a summary of it. But the natural rights view is I can only do those things, and I can only give the government the power that I myself was given by God. I have the power to do this thing, so therefore I can give it to that. In my mind, one of the driving or main differences is the natural rights view puts the person in charge of government. And a social contract, if you look at it from my point of view, it's more deplorable than he would think it is, but it puts government in charge of the people. So the natural rights says the people are in charge and they tell government what to do. And to me, they're limiting it. They're saying, we know this is a grant of power. We don't like just letting government decide for us, so we're going to limit them, not just, well, government, go ahead. Saying, I don't really care if you don't want me to take out your engine, I'm going to. And I'm like, but it's my car, and I'm the one who's on the hook to pay for it, and I don't want you to do that. And that's why I said, just do those things that are necessary, and I consider necessary absolute. I mean, we could talk about that, right? I mean, so John Marshall, lawyer, like, he knows how to wordsmith things. I gave that guy 10, he'd be able to also find in the same ruling that there's a conservative view on the necessary and proper clause. Even in the McCullough versus Maryland case, he said, look, it's long been established that Congress can only do those things that are enumerated or given to them. He even said that himself. But then he went on to say, well, yeah, but there's a difference between necessary and absolutely necessary. I'm like, necessary, not just, hey. I think that opens the door to government doing bigger things. And in the end, what I see is a bigger government that's doing all kinds of things. And we see that in a $28 trillion. We see that in especially the federal government getting their hands involved in all kinds of issues, economically, socially, religiously, all these things that are coming down. And it's true. I can't think of a Supreme Court ruling that hasn't allowed and enabled the expanded version of the interpretation of the General Welfare Clause and the expanded version of the Necessary and Proper Clause. So once again, like we talked about last month, I'm here talking about how it should be, but that's not how it is how Mr. Hancock's explaining it. That's how it is. But I'm saying it shouldn't be. You should follow the Constitution. Look at it literally.
So both of you, and this is great. So both of you are spoke in your lecture about Jeffersonian and the Jeffersonian and Hamilton way of looking at the Necessary and Proper Clause. And you suggested, David, that Hamilton takes a more implied powers type of that, you know, the Constitution, the government implied powers to do what it needs to do. And, you know, Jefferson, of course, took the approach that, you know, it only should do what is specifically enumerated in the Constitution. So, you know, what are your thoughts on, you know, how did this Jeffersonian notion and this, you know, Hamilton notion kind of, where do we see that emerge today in current politics? If we're thinking about to our audience, arguments at play regarding the necessary and proper clause in today's politics?
You know, I think that's a great question, because when we start looking at what is necessary and proper, trying to decide where does this go, most of it comes down into clauses in one, Section 8. And the Commerce Clause is probably the biggest one that, you know, Congress has gotten in that pair of pants, so to speak, about as much as they can. They've really stretched that particular clause out as that being played out is in various agreements that the government has. So, for example, the Endangered Species Act, I think, is one where they say, hey, we get to decide which animals, plants, which life forms are commercially important and which ones aren't. And therefore, Congress says the sugar bloom plant, which most of you probably have never seen, it grows in the deserts of Southern California, and they say the checkered bloom plant is endangered, so we need to protect it. And if you happen to own some property where the checkered bloom plant is growing, then that's kind of too bad for you. You can't build on that land unless you pay all this money, mitigate the costs and the impact on the checkered bloom plant and whatever. And we see that played out on all kinds of different species. And I think that's an example of a place where we have Congress saying, hey, we get to see the end. Is it commerce? Yeah. And, but we're the ones that get to decide the means. Animals and plants sold commercially, then we get to decide everything that is appropriate to trade in interstate commerce and those that aren't. And that's where people can be concerned, is the ability to have Congress control a level that, you know, probably the founding fathers didn't anticipate. Acknowledge that.
Yeah, I mean, with the ADA, right, with EPA, so the Civilities Act, the Environmental Protection Agency, so those same kind of concepts, those same kind of ideas, where those are very alive and well today. Anyone who's in a business or starts a business, the hoops you have to jump through, I think for me, I consider them to be hoops, are challenging because government has gotten in the position that we decide, and we're going to tell you, instead of the people saying, no, we decide, and we tell you what you can do. And I think we get into some challenges there. Some of the arguments against the EPA or against the ADA or against OSHA, National Safety and Health Administration, all these different kind of governmental mandates and federal mandates that kind of encroach on individual freedom, I think kind of the purest arguments against that is let the market figure it out itself. Like if the ADA, for example, the Disabilities Act, if you create make a restaurant, you have to have so many egresses and ingresses and entrances that people in wheelchairs can get in and out. I would think the owner of the restaurant would want to do that as a matter of decency, and if they don't do it, I'd imagine the free market would say, we don't like this, and not just that I have somebody who's handicapped in my family, but I don't like the fact that you won't take it, so I'm not going to go to your restaurant. I may even picket or boycott or tell a bunch of people not to. The free market could solve that. To have the federal government come in and say, we're going to do this, and we're going to have this huge regulatory expense to make sure, because we think it's in the general welfare of the United States to make sure that every restaurant has all these handicap accessible entrances, to me goes too far. And so in terms of, you know, maybe some of the applicable stuff today, I think that's real. I think it's a real concern. But how do you see that differently? I almost feel like you're saying the same thing I'm saying.
Well, the way that I see it differently is you're saying they don't have that power, and I'm saying they do.
Oh, but do you agree that it's an improper use of that power?
No, I don't think it's necessarily an improper use of the power. What I think is that the propriety of the power, whether or not it's proper, is decided through federalism, because the states are represented in the Senate, individual people are represented, or groups of individual people are represented in the House, that that's where those checks and balances come in. So I see it more as a structural method or a means of restricting congressional overreach rather than the necessary and proper clause being interpreted. And most of the Supreme Court cases that have looked at necessary and proper clause in the last, oh, probably 80 to 90 years, where they have said, hey, we're getting close to that line, what they've set it on is when the federal government starts encroaching on state powers. And so, to me, what it is saying, look, that and needs to be proper. In other words, it needs to be something that's authorized by the Constitution. But once it's authorized by the Constitution, then we have this broad range of means that we can pick. And sometimes it's only slight, it does relate. And so the Supreme Court typically has not struck down those statutes just because they do something else. Federalism rather than saying, hey, this is something that Congress can't do.
So essentially, David, you're suggesting that the power to do what it needs to do when it's taxing and spending, but you personally may not agree with their way of using, you know, their way of using that power for the Endangered Species Act, for example, or other environmental protection laws.
Yeah, I think that Congress makes lots of bad decisions, but they have the power to make some bad decisions, and the check on them is they then have to stand for re-election. That we have other things going on in the nation which can provide that check. States can exercise their rights. So we see that, for example, with a lot of the COVID-19 restrictions, the states are suing back. They're saying, hey, you can't do this, and they're pushing back against the federal government. They're saying, you claim that this is authorized under the Occupation Safety Hazard Administration, or the Safety Hazard Act, and we think that's too much. So we're gonna go to court, we're gonna push back, and there's gonna be it's gonna play out in the courts as to who's right, the states or the federal government. But the idea that they don't, I think the idea that they don't have that power at all leads us into a different parade of horribles, where Congress's hands are tied so tightly that they can't do anything. And so you look at McCullough versus Maryland. This is the case where this all came about, involving the Second Bank of the United States. They decided that a bank was convenient. A bank was convenient because they needed a way to collect taxes. They needed a way to pay various things, and they needed a way to distribute the money that they had coined. And they said, hey, a great way to do that would be to have a bank. And people said, no, you can't build a bank. And the Supreme Court said, well, you know, there's probably a couple of ways you could do this, but you get to decide which one. So it's like, you know, you go out on a date and you say, hey, do I want steak or do I want chicken? And you get to pick. Your wife didn't say, hey, you don't get to pick what kind. It said, hey, you get to take me to dinner or whatever. And you get that, I don't know if that's a good example. It's probably not a good example. Yeah. I'm seeing a lot of shaking.
Not to be careful.
I'm just
going to
stop now. I'm just going to stop right now.
What are your thoughts? What disagreements do you have? Where do you think David here is incorrect in this notion that government's hands, that the implications of government's hands being tied actually present more problems than when you're limiting their power?
Yeah, I think I want to address that as the second question. The first one. What did you say? It was interesting. Oh, one of our pet peeves is when students, you know, that's a bad decision. It's unconstitutional. I want to make sure I'm very clear, too. Just because something's a bad decision doesn't make it unconstitutional. And that's where you're saying, no, you got to back up here. I'm not deciding or judging the correctness or goodness or morality even of these decisions. I'm just saying they are allowed in the Constitution. And I fully agree there are many things the government does that I don't like, that we don't like, that we think is immoral, bad, poorly thought out, etc., but it's still constitutional. But in this area, in general terms, these areas where we do disagree, I say, no, it's not just that it's a bad idea, it's that it is patently unconstitutional. So your second question was what?
Just in terms of, so David made the argument that the implications of government's hands being tied are actually more problematic than if you were to actually to limit government.
Yeah,
according to your interpretation.
I think that's a great thing. It's great for the federal government's hands to be tied. That's like, oh yeah, that's exactly what we want. Thomas Jefferson said, I would rather be exposed to the inconveniences attending too much liberty than to those attending too small a degree of it. And there's no silver bullet. There's no like, oh, if we could just have this certain way, then we never have any problems. I agree. If you took a Jeffersonian approach and you had very small government, their hands pretty much tied, we would have some chaos. We'd have some problems. We'd have some challenges. We'd have some free market fallout, right? And I'd say, that's great, because then who's going to fix it? The free market. The people offer the best price at the lowest cost. The organizations who think through, hey, the best way to treat issues as racism, the best way to treat issues about the environment is to satisfy parties, to talk to them, to negotiate, to think through, and we do it efficiently because no one is on top saying, you will do it this way, and you must fill out these 10,000 reports, and you must pay this huge fee. I think, to me, that's I agree there are some areas. I think there are some areas where you do need to enable government, and I think the founders and James Madison, many of them say from the get-go, what we're here doing in the Constitutional Convention in 1787 is creating a bigger, stronger government, because that's what we need. We need a stronger government. But I would say that they aren't saying, as I said before, we need a stronger government with like very few limits. No, we need a stronger government that's entailed within the boundaries, right? Jefferson talked about prescribing the powers of Congress within this boundary. And once you pop that bubble, there's pretty much nowhere it can't go. And I think that's the problem. And so I think we're getting more distinct. Hopefully it's clear to the audience what our differences are. And I would say if government is handicapped too much, that is a problem. To be fair, there are certain areas where individual liberty is the right answer, and it actually inhibits. Individual liberty isn't always the right answer. There are times when it's not the right answer, when it actually does create chaos and anarchy. The federal government kind of coming down and saying, well, we can see that, oh, there's the thing we're going to do, so therefore we can tax and spend to do it, or therefore it's necessary. And I think that's, in my view, that's what happened in Nicole versus Maryland, is John Marshall essentially said that, like, yeah, we can see how it's not really tied to borrowing and creating, you know, coining money, et cetera, but it is convenient. And since it's convenient, it kind of relates to clause two, and it kind of relates to clause five. We're going to let them do a bank, even though, oh no. But to be fair, when Jefferson got in the hot seat and he was the president and he had to make a decision that was going to help America incredibly, and 10 million, I think 15, anyway, millions of dollars, but a very small cost for the Louisiana Purchase, Jefferson kind of said, just buy it. I mean, there's really no, let's just do this thing, or this is the right thing to do. And I don't know, say something that makes it sound right, but it's the right thing to do, let's just do it. I mean, so there are times where expediency rules, I don't know. I guess I'm a staunch diehard Jeffersonian, and then I'm like, well, then he did the right thing and it was right to ignore the Constitution in this case. Or I can say, no, the Constitution is wrong, but I'm glad he did it. You know, I don't know.
You know, I think the Louisiana Purchase is a great example of how this too strict of an interpretation of the Necessary and Proper Clause would have greatly cost the United States.
Yeah.
The offer from France was for a limited time. Napoleon needed the money now, and it was at a fire sale. I mean, it was like, let's sell off all this land, and you get it for a cheap, 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 cheap price.
5 cents an acre. Right?
Yeah, it was incredibly cheap. And Jefferson originally thought, hey, do I go out and call back Congress to approve a constitutional amendment and hope that the states approve it? And he ultimately said, nah, we're just going to buy it.
Because the amendment would have been the constitutional remedy, right? We have to go through the process. Like, yeah, but it's going to take forever. We're not going to.
And I think that's the reality that we're looking at, is we're looking at some things, and Congress has to say, hey, can we do this? And they say, well, we've got the power here. I can see that we have the power to declare war. Does that mean that we can only declare war? Or can we do anything up to and including declaring war? And, you know, and that gets to be some subtle distinctions, is trying to decide, what does that mean? Do we have to have a constitutional amendment every time we want to send troops off that we think will help protect America? And that's a great question and a real debate that we'll talk about another night. Not necessarily tonight, but anyway. And I think that's where it comes down to this, to the Necessary and Proper Clause and how it really does impact things.
Yeah, and to be fair, there are many Louisiana Purchase-esque decisions all the time. And, you know, even me, who's like the champion of individual rights, et cetera, I mean, there are times where I think you have to look and be fair and say there are times where the government does need to make a decision that's not popular. Because they have information and they can see what we can't see. It's a republic. They're representatives, and they do move forward. And so, you know, there are times if you want to I don't know. I think there are exceptions, and I don't know necessarily how to phrase that. But to be fair, I think there are some times where like, well, that makes sense, and I think it's the right thing to do, but it's not quite. So yeah, even the strict interpreter is saying, I don't know. Sometimes it doesn't quite. It's not that simple. It's not that simple.
I'm going to convert him to my side eventually. You keep doing this. By the end of the month, he's going to be converted.
Don't hold your breath.
Well, I think this is a great chance to move into our Q&A portion of our debate, and we'll continue the debate through your questions. And so we'd love to hear questions from our live audience. We have a live mic over here on the side. So if there's anyone that has a question that they'd like to ask, we have about 15 minutes for questions this evening. We also will take questions on the YouTube live feed. So if there's anybody that's joining us remotely that has a burning question, we'd also love to receive your questions as well. So with that, if you have a question, please come and line up over here on the side at the mic. We'll take our first question.
Okay, I'm 75 years old. Shortly before I was born, World War II developed the atomic bomb. The federal government created the Atomic Energy Commission. That sounds pretty reasonable. You don't want civilians, especially, making atomic bombs. So you have the federal government in charge of that. But that's been morphed through the years to now become a Department of Energy, which I view as a great usurpation by the federal government. Why should the federal government be in charge of all energy, including fossil fuel energy, electricity, all manner of forms of energy? Now they want to be in charge of all of it. And under their emergency powers, they want to seize my ability to make electricity. I have 11 kilowatts of solar panels on my roof. I make more electricity than I use and put it back out onto the grid. Why should they be in charge of my electricity that I paid for? So in my mind, I can't justify the usurpation over the years that the federal government has done in this area. What's your view on it?
I think that's a great question, and I think that really highlights the difficulty of necessary and proper general welfare and this whole issue. And the classic response that I would give has to do with the express power of, in Article 1, Section 8, Clause 5, Commerce Clause, is it 5? 3. See, Jeff knows the numbers way better than I do. Clause 3, the Commerce Clause, which allows the federal government to control anything that passes in interstate commerce. Now, there's no doubt that that has been expanded over the years. And there's also no doubt that energy is something that passes in interstate commerce. You look at the state of Utah, we have a lot of natural gas, a lot of oil, we have a lot of coal. And it goes throughout the United States and through various places. And as soon as that is injected into the stream of interstate commerce, Congress can latch its fingers onto it and can say, hey, we're going to regulate that. And that's what they've chosen to do. And sometimes it hurts when we do that, but on the other hand, it's also good because when we try to sell our coal to California, they don't get to tax it at the border. And they don't get to prohibit it. In fact, there was a story in KSL that I saw earlier this week, and I haven't had a chance to investigate it, but something about how Utah coal would no longer be able to be stored in San Francisco after 2027. And I'm kind of curious how that works. I suspect that that's some kind of a contract based off of some other things. I haven't looked into it. But I think that the Commerce Clause there protects us as much as it hurts us. There was also a Supreme Court case during the Great Depression where they were regulating the ability of people to grow wheat and to sell and buy wheat. And one of the things that the New Deal legislation said is, if you're growing wheat in your backyard, we have the ability to prohibit you from doing that. I personally think that that's a very bad decision on the part of Congress. I think that it's way overreach. But the argument that they made is, look, if you're growing wheat, then you're not buying wheat in the market. And I can see the argument. Now, I think that's where we're getting down to that question of, is that necessary? Is that proper? And the Supreme Court upheld that, and I disagree with it. I think that that is going too far. And so the ability to put solar panels on your roof or to have a windmill, I think that that should be something that is much, much greater. But I do acknowledge that Congress has the ability under the Commerce Clause to do some regulation on that.
Yeah, I just see it as kind of a slippery slope, like by degrees, right? The frog in the water, and just keep turning up a little bit. Because I think your first point was that it seemed to make sense, the Atomic Energy Commission. I like it when things make sense, and it makes sense for government to get involved with it, but I like that that's done not just under the purview of, well, it makes sense, we're going to do it. I think it should be done. I don't know a ton about atomic energy and that whole situation, but if we're going to make a major shift or major turn, I think it needs to be done officially through like an amendment process, not just everyone knows what we should do, so let's do it, and attach that to necessary and proper, attach that to interstate commerce clause, attach that to the general welfare clause, because then we end up just having a government that kind of does what they think makes sense, and they just kind of do what they want to do, and that puts them in charge. And so I think if we're fine saying the Atomic Energy Commission is good, but then they've taken that too far and created the Department of Energy, I think in maybe kind of narrow mind of it, I think we need to go back to saying, well, if we're fine, let's make sure it's official. Let's not just say we're fine and move on. We gotta have some type of official statement about how we're gonna handle this. So it's not just government making the decision all the time, not just on the fly saying, oh, we think it works, we don't think it works.
Thank you both. Let's go ahead and have our next question.
So I've been witnessing you've been debating on the two clauses, but what I ultimately realize is that you guys, by hearing and getting to know one another better and understanding the similarities and differences, is what is so great about this debate. And I was just wanting to know what your guys' thought about that is.
About the similarities and differences of the two clauses? Wait, that's what we've been trying to. Can you give a little more specific example?
Because like how the greater importance behind this debate is like getting to know one another.
The underlying message, right? So I'll go ahead on that, James. I think that's pretty perceptive. That's what I find. I find my own personal. I was talking to my wife about this just yesterday. When I talk about stuff, like, I don't talk about David's point of view. I talk about my point of view, and I try to get people who agree with me, and I get this echo chamber. I'm like, they have no idea what's going on. Like they can't even think straight. They're just liberal, or you know. And I don't. And it's important. What I've learned as I've gotten to be good friends with David, and I'm always asking him questions. He always has answers, and they always make sense to me. I'm learning that I think that's what you're saying, James. That there's value in that. The value is to understand and be civilly engaged and be willing to listen and say that makes sense. And I don't know if that even feels comfortable or actually makes me question my thoughts, but that's all right, because I want to change. I want to learn. I want to understand. I think we're both passionate about our positions, but I think we're even more passionate, and the reason this has worked with this center and with the class we teach, we're even more passionate about people understanding other people's points of view. So that's really perceptive.
I just want to point out that from my perspective, I'm on the right. you know, the ability that Jeff and I have had over the last, I don't know, 4 years, 5 years. We started talking in the lunchroom, in the faculty lounge about things and passing. And I'll be honest, at first I thought that he was crazy. I thought, oh man, here comes this crazy guy who thinks he knows the Constitution and he's going to tempt. But the more that I listen to Jeff, the more that I understand where he's coming from, and the more that I see where he's coming from, and I appreciate what he says because I learn things from it. And he said the same thing about me. I don't always agree with him. In fact, there's a lot of times I don't agree with him. But the discourse, the ability to sit and talk with each other, and we've become good friends. Even though we disagree with each other on a lot of things, in fact, we sat down to make a list of what we were going to cover in our class, and that fast, we had a list of 15 things, and we
10 minutes. Right?
It was 10 minutes, and we could keep going. But if the process of talking with him and hearing his point of view and listening while he explains, and then me getting to explain back to him my point of view, has been very valuable for both of us. It's moved me closer to him politically, and I think he would admit that he's moved closer to me politically.
Yeah, I think what I found, if I may, you know, as I've watched you two debate, is how reasonable you are and willing you are to accept, to stick to your, you know, philosophical perspective, but also be willing to admit that there are equitable exceptions to your viewpoint. And I find that as I watch both of you, it kind of reminds me of how an ideal Thanksgiving dinner would go. So something to keep in mind in a few days. Next question.
So follow-up question to that gentleman down there. Was the making of the atomic bomb constitutional? Because just pushing the button to destroy a ton of people, would that be constitutional? Or did something justify that, or was that unconstitutional?
You want to go first on that one? I draw the line on atomic weapons, so go ahead.
No, you go ahead. I'm thinking, I don't know.
You know, that is a really great question, and that brings down to the crux of that issue, is what are the powers? And, you know, you see that Congress has the power to declare war. What does that mean? And how far does that go? Yeah, do you have the power to kill millions of people or hundreds of thousands of people in a single act of war? And that was something that was difficult. I do think that they had the power to do that. From historical perspective, I don't think that Congress as a whole knew that we were developing the atomic weapon. I think historically it was mostly kept in the dark, but they were funding projects that they knew were war projects that were very expensive. And I think that goes into that general welfare clause. They were spending for the general welfare. They were spending for what they thought would be generally in the welfare of the United States, to keep the United States free. But was the end exactly what they anticipated? I don't think so. But the President of the United States knew, various members of the military knew, various members of other part of government knew. But I think that is really a great question. And that's where we have to look at this and we say, this isn't just an academic question regarding what does general, what does welfare, what does necessary, what does proper mean? Because there we're talking about lives. And it is a really serious question. But ultimately, I would say, I do believe that was something that Congress had the power to spend money on.
Yeah, I'll just make it short. I think, in general, the Congress has the power to declare war, it says in Article 1, Section 8, Clause 11. And then at that point, my view on how this works, we will talk about this later probably, is that at that point, that's only when the president becomes the commander-in-chief. And so if the president says, okay, in order to execute this war, because I've given authorization by the Congress, who represents the people who give their blood and treasure to make this war happen, then he's fully authorized. But I do think you bring up a good point, is the development for that happened long before the authorization. The authorization was kind of, I think they should have been openly informed about what they're voting on and what they're going to do, rather than just kind of this backdoor secret thing to where all of a sudden, okay, we're gonna use this, should we use it? And it's no longer in the hands of Congress, it's in the hands of the president. I think in general, the Congress should make decisions about what to do, and the president should carry it out. And I think the atomic bomb kind of got that a little bit backwards. Like, we're just going to do this thing behind the scenes. Congress never really approved it. We are at war. They approved that. But now the president's just going to drop it. I think there's some issues there where there needs to be a little bit more accountability to the people, not just to the commander-in-chief in the situation. So it's interesting. I never thought about that in that way, but those are some thoughts that come to my mind.
Very good. I'd love to see the student participation. Evan has our next question.
The Biden administration recently announced a far-reaching mandate for the COVID-19 vaccine for employees, or be fined. This subject does not seem to fit under the tax and spend requirement, but may be viewed as promoting general welfare. How do you each feel about this requirement?
Great question.
That's amazing.
Yeah, they're getting hit with tough ones from the students.
Wow. So you say it doesn't really fall under tax and spend, but it could be argued that it falls under general welfare. Yeah, I think my simplistic view of that is this idea, right? That general welfare has to apply to where are they trying to tie this to? If the current president says we need to do a certain thing for the general welfare, they say great, okay. Which general welfare clause are you referring to? And if they can't tie that to the specific, you know, number two, which is borrow money, or number three is interstate commerce, or number four, which is naturalization, or number five, which is coin money, or number six, right? If they can't actually tie it to it, then I'm like, well, then that's just a mandate that doesn't hold water. There is an interesting comment that Alexander Hamilton said in Federalist 87. He said, 87 or 78 or 85, one of those. No, anyway, one of those three. He said, look, if a general body gives power to government to do a certain thing, then they have to follow it. Whether you like it or not, you have to follow it. But if that general body never gave them the power to do it in the first place, then it should be treated like any other unconstitutional mandate. They should ignore it. They should fight against it. So.
Got some support out in the audience there.
I think that President Biden's vaccine mandate that is currently not enforced, just so that you know, it's been put on hold, and the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeal has issued a rule staying it, but I think it is unconstitutional. I think that it goes too far. And I think it's unconstitutional for several reasons. I think one reason that it's not valid, not necessarily unconstitutional, is because the Occupational Safety and Hazard Act doesn't actually authorize OSHA to do what they did. I don't think they followed the rulemaking procedure, which is a different set of problems. And I also think that the federal government doesn't have that ability, doesn't have that power, even under the Commerce Clause. I think that that's a power that is a state power. And so I get to the same place as Jeff, I just get to it from a different direction. But on this one, I agree with him. Oh man, the cameras are running.
Okay, just in the interest of time, we probably have time for just one more question. You ready? This is another tough one on the live feed. Hey, Nathaniel here, good to hear your voices. If this isn't too divisive, I was wondering what your opinion of the Second Amendment is in regards to the Kyle Rittenhouse trial. And maybe, tying this to the Necessary and Proper Clause, I think there's been a lot of discussion whether or not Congress could potentially deem it necessary and proper to limit what some would see as, you know, their rights under the Second Amendment.
Whew, this is where I'm going to get myself in a lot of trouble. Jeff and I's position actually are different on this than what people might think. In this case, my view of the Second Amendment is that it says what it says, and it means what it says. That the people have the right to keep and bear arms, and that there are not or should not be constitutional limits on that right. Now, that's what I believe the Second Amendment says. I also believe that the Second Amendment should be repealed. I think that it says what it says, and I agree with what it says. And so I think that Kyle Rittenhouse was justified in his use of force, and that's what the jury found today, in case you haven't heard the news. The jury verdict came back today, and he was acquitted on all five counts. But I think that it was an appropriate use of force under the law. But my view is that I would be happy to see the Second Amendment repealed. But I think it has to go through the process. I think that it's wrong for Congress to try to pick away at it and slowly erode the Second Amendment. I think that if we want something different in our country, that we should change it, not try to go at it through the back door.
Jeff?
Which, yeah, not speaking of the Second Amendment or the Kyle Rittenhouse case, but that's exactly my point. When, if we want to change stuff, you have to change it through the Article 5, which says how to change things, and not to just kind of pick away at stuff, right, and just kind of let Congress decide what they're going to do or not to do. I don't think we actually don't have any disagreement on how we see the Kyle Rittenhouse case playing out. I'm glad, I hadn't read that, I'm glad that's what happened. I think there's a lot of politicization of the case. And I think that was really unfortunate for a young man who was really in a situation that's pretty straightforward self-defense. To me, this would be a prime example of how necessary and proper. The Congress can't just jump in and say, well, we just think this is necessary and proper. We just think the general welfare, you know, of course, it's not Congress making this decision, it's the Supreme Court. But we can't have government getting in there and just kind of choosing how to apply. No. Here's what it says, and therefore we have to follow it. And if you want to change it, you have to amend it.
Very good. We have an agreement between, we'll end the night on that agreement, I say. With that, I just want to say how lucky we are this evening to have been taught by these amazing teachers. What a privilege it's been. Let's give them one more round of applause. We'd like to express our gratitude to those of you who have joined as parents, students, employees, faculty. Thank you so much for joining us this evening. Those on the live feed as well, thank you for your participation. We'd also like to thank the AHS school administrators for allowing us to put this on, and also Don Morgan and his team on the technology this evening. Thank you. Yeah, let's give them a round of applause. Yes. Just a couple things to make note of before, as we conclude. You'll note that we will not have a Constitutional Literacy Series event in December due to the proximity to the holidays. And we do invite you to attend our next event, which will take place on January 21st at the same time, 7 p.m. We hope that you'll join us here in-house. This has actually been our largest audience this time, and we hope to see it continue to grow. So please tell your friends and family about what we're trying to do here. It's a great opportunity to come and enjoy and learn on a Friday evening. We would just like to wish you, also one other thing to note, our website has gone live. So if you go to ahsccc.org, that will take you to the Constitution and Civility Center website, where there are resources there, including archived videos of each of our events that have taken place this year. Also, if you would like to join our email list, there is a list out in the lobby for you to just put your email so you can get on our email list so we can send you notifications each time we have an event. The same goes for those on the live stream. If you want to include in the chat your email, we'll make sure to get you recorded so when we send out an email to remind you, then you'll know when these events are coming up. Otherwise, we'd love to wish you a very happy Thanksgiving and a wonderful holiday season. Good night and thank you.